Goedenavond, welkom bij de eerste livestream van Tika Travel. Fijn dat u er bent. Het is voor ons ook een beetje uitproberen, want de eerste keer. Maar we hebben vanavond een zeer bijzondere gast voor u. De eerste spreker in de Tika Travel Speakers Academy, die we van de week hebben gelanceerd voor onze klanten, is vanavond bij ons te gast Christel Brandt uit Zuid-Afrika. Een hele bijzondere man waar u binnenkort kennis mee gaat maken. En ik ga u straks nog verder aan u voorstellen. Misschien kort in het begin voor wie ons nog niet kent als Tika Travel. Wij zijn in 1989, heb ik het voorrecht gehad om Tika Travel te mogen oprichten. Destijds in Zimbabwe met reizen naar Zimbabwe. En later zijn wij breder over de wereld uitgebreid met specifieke reizen gericht op natuur en wildlife. Wij maken reizen op maat. Die typerend zijn voor de bestemming, de natuur die we bezoeken. Kenmerkend in die reizen, ook om diepgang te geven aan de reizen, zijn speciale mensen om te ontmoeten, speciale gidsen die u ergens bijzondere dingen kunnen laten zien of deuren kunnen openen die elders gesloten blijven of zelfs niet bekend zijn. En één daarvan is Christel Brandt. Ik heb het geluk gehad om Christel te mogen ontmoeten in Zuid-Afrika in mei jongsleden. En het werd mij direct duidelijk wat voor bijzondere man dat was. En ik heb hem samen met onze partners in deze week van presentaties en talks die Christel heeft gehouden, Marjolein Westerter van het blad Oog voor Afrika, gevraagd om naar Nederland te komen om zijn achtergronden en zijn bijzondere belevingen met wellicht de meest belangrijkste politicus en überhaupt Afrikaan ooit, Nelson Mandela, met ons en vanavond met u te delen. Ik schakel zo dadelijk over naar het Engels en stelt u gerust vragen, want daar is deze livestream voor, om een Q&A op te zetten. En zodat u specifieke vragen die bij u leven ook direct aan Christel kunt stellen. Christel, welcome again.
Thank you.
We've had a long week together and very interesting. And may I ask you to give us a short introduction?
I must first thank Tika Travel in Oog voor Afrika Marjolein for having the opportunity to be in the Netherlands.
Thank you.
And also be the first speaker on your program. I'm very privileged to be there. But people ask where I come from. I grew up on a farm where I was the only white child playing with African children, where one was one day disrespectful to the elder African man, where my father gave me a hiding and said, the man can be black but a human being like us. God has made all different colors, different look alike, we must respect each other. So I become many years later a prison warder on Robben Island, guarding prisoners like Nelson Mandela, Walter Sisulu and all of them. But they told us when we arrived there, we're going to meet the biggest criminals in the history of South Africa.
Yeah.
When I was trained to work with criminals during my training, I worked with real gangsters. Yeah, I worked with humble, old people who treat me with respect, totally different environment. And then I was informed later, when I asked what type of criminals it is, they said it's a terrorist who killed my friends on the border. A lot of white children died on the border fighting with clashes with black people. I was supposed to hate these people. But when I see how old they are, how humble they are, how friendly they are, and what they fight for, I could have made hate them. We become friends.
Yeah. That's the special thing.
That's a special bond. Start on Robben Island, but between me and Mandela and others.
Yeah. How was it for you growing up in such a tolerant and inclusive family? In the countryside, being able to play with black and white children at the same time?
You know, in the countryside, my father was just a foreman.
Yeah.
And we were very poor. There were no other white children for me to play with. I played with him, grew up with him, on the farm, understand black people.
Yeah.
But when we moved to the city, it was totally the opposite. There was no African children to play with, but no colored children to play with, only white children. And then I see the discrimination, and that was really painful when I heard about discrimination in the country. Yeah. And my father was not a politician. He was not interested in the politics of the country. He always said the biggest crime in our country is discrimination. We mustn't discriminate in human beings. We mustn't discriminate against the color of the skins. So that is the biggest problem which we have in that time where I grew up.
Yeah, must have been very difficult.
It was difficult, yes.
And then you enlisted with the prison wardens, and you became a guard on Robben Island. That was after your short period with the as you say, the highest criminals in South Africa, killing each other in the jails and everything. Then you were transferred to another place, to even more scary people, as you were told.
Yes.
And then what happened?
We become friends.
Yeah.
We start understanding. It happened there, where I see how hard they work in the limestone valley, how the prison authorities try to break these prisoners. They say they're in for hard labor.
Yeah.
And they try to break their correspondence, break the relationship with the family, break the ties to the family, and punish these people unnecessarily. It was painful for me to see what they go through.
They were not treated like human beings.
And they were not treated like human beings. That is in the limestone quarry, for instance, to start with. And they are working in that quarry for more than 12 years. And it does blow in my eyes and burn me that first day that I could have not seen the prisoners. I could have not believed that these people already been blind. That's why Mandela, when he was released, he struggled with his eyes. Where they worked later years on the rocks, getting the sea kelps out of the sea, the bamboos. Where he slipped and broke his ankle, injured his knee, he could have not walked, where they punished him and all that, and punishment he gone through on the island, that I could have not believed how these people can survive 27 years in prison.
Yeah, that's amazing. In your book, which we will talk about a little bit later, you say you never really realized apartheid was there until you were older. When did you realize that it was, in fact, something that was happening?
76 was an uprising.
Yeah.
I heard black people burn their schools, but I didn't realize what was the situation. Till I started work on Robben Island, and I see what is Mandela and others fight for.
Yeah.
They want equal, people must live equally. And they were fighting that we must be equal. Then I start realize, but what they're fighting for is not a crime. To be equal, human beings, living in the same street, same place, married each other, if you fall in love with each other, that is not a crime for me, because God has put us all on the earth for the same reason, to live on the earth. But why they must be discriminated? That was the first time in 1980, I realized that this is wrong.
Yeah.
But there was no other way for me to work in a prison service, because I don't want to go to the military. In the military, we was forced to kill black people on the borders.
Yeah.
We was forced to work in the townships to disrupt black people in communities. And I was not there to take up firearms to do this. My nephews, for instance, refused, and they end up in military prison.
Yep.
They was being sentenced for 7 years military prison, work as criminal prisoners. I was looking for alternatives,
yep.
And I want to do something in my life. And then a gentleman visited our school. They're looking for prison warders. And then I didn't really want to become a prison warder.
No.
But what he told me, I said, I want to become an electrician. He said, that's a right opportunity. Train as a prison warden, you can train prisoners to become better people. Give them classes in electricity and they also can become electricians, which never happened.
Yeah. How did working at Robben Island, because you never told your relatives that you worked with these famous, later famous prisoners, how did that affect your relationship with families and friends?
Okay, I can just mention something. When I just start working on Robben Island, my first weekend, it was after 6 weeks, I go to the mainland.
Yes.
When my uncle visited my parents that evening, and my father said, I work on Robben Island. My father didn't know who was kept in Robben Island. My uncle was the one who said, but have you seen Nelson Mandela? At that stage, I didn't know who's Nelson Mandela. I see the names. And then my father asked, who is Nelson Mandela? Then my uncle said, that's a man who tried to overthrow the government of the time. But in the news, you still want to know if the man is still alive, because people don't know.
Yeah.
That's the first time I do my research. When I go back to prison that Monday, find out who's Nelson Mandela, then I see the old man walking there.
Yeah.
And I try to identify him with it. And then I start reading things up about it and look through his files, look at correspondence, look at the newspaper reports. Then I see what he was in for.
Yeah.
It was the first time. But my parents didn't know even Nelson Mandela. Where we grow up on a farm and things, was not really news available.
Yeah. you had no television, you
see. And we didn't have television, was not in that years.
Yeah.
So we was not uninformed.
Yeah.
But I never talked to my parents that I got Nelson Mandela. We was not allowed to talk what prisons you look after. And they never even asked me. Mm-hmm. All what I was doing when I fishing on the island, I take some fresh fish weekends. If I can go home, weekends home, my parents were very happy for the fish and everything.
Yeah, yeah.
And I was worried about my life. I worked with these criminals.
Yeah.
Né, because they said life prisoners. I was worried that they can stab me. I said, my father, no, they are quite relaxed. They are retired already in prison. But I never mentioned further.
And then you realized that these so-called criminals were proper human beings. And what did that do to you? What was your relationship with prisoners?
My relationship with these prisoners became like my father taught me. Respect elderly people. The respect Mandela have towards me and Sisulu and all of them have towards me. Yeah. I treat them with the same respect.
Yeah.
They was humble, friendly, and they always let me feel, I was 18 years old, Mandela was 60 that years.
Yeah.
Some was older than him. And they treat me with that respect as if I their senior in charge. I could not believe that the old person respect me as the most senior person in this room.
Yeah.
Where they are actually supposed to be the seniors.
Yeah. Must have been special.
It was special.
Yeah. And how often were the prisoners allowed to see other people? Were they able to receive visitors?
Prisoners was allowed to receive visitors, was strictly controlled. And that year when I started in Romanand, Mandela received one visit every 3 months for 30 minutes. That time he received also one letter every 3 months, or plus minus 450 words to 500 words. And can send out one letter. But when Mandela came to prison, which I looked through his files, he was in the beginning only one letter allowed every 6 months. And one letter every 6 months. But it became a little bit more.
Yeah, yeah. And you explained me earlier this week about one of the special visits that you allowed on the island involving Winnie Mandela, when she came and wanted to show him a special surprise. Can you tell us a little bit more about that?
What happened, Winnie Mandela came to visit him on Robben Island to get a permit. When she get on a boat, because there was discrimination also, because on a boat, first load the officers and the wives first, then we load the warders and their families, and lastly we load the visitors to the prisoners. And the visitors to prison was all colored, Asian, of African people. There was no white people allowed to visit the prison on Robben Island.
Not at all.
Not at all. Except there was Afrikaans priest, which was a white guy, which was sent from the NG church that time, which now and then visit in the prison Kapelaan, which visited him. But otherwise, visitors to prison was all black people, if I put that way. So Winnie Mandela came with a boat because she was also not allowed to sit inside the boat. There was discrimination. She always prepared about the bad weather to Robben Island. Robben Island weather you can't trust. Today is windy, tomorrow is rough seas and rain conditions. But that time when she came was winter time. So she came with a blanket over her African dress. She always tried to dress very nice in orange, bright colors, and nice African dress. But she put a blanket around that, and over the blanket she put a raincoat, an umbrella. And so she traveled to Robben Island with her boat. When she arrived there, get off, we observed when she take these things off, she put a baby infant with her.
Really?
Children was not allowed to be seen by prisoners. We were supposed to stop this visit. But what happened during the visit? She left the baby behind in the waiting room with other visitors. She told her husband through this window, because I speak through a window on a telephone, communicate with each other, told him that she had brought his grandchild to Robben Island. Mandela looked very excited to me and he requested me very nice, Mr. Brandt, is it possible to see the child? Which my answer was no. Not what I feel to tell him, but the regulations said so and everything was recorded.
Yeah.
National intelligence listened in, security branch with a copy of records, my superior is there, I could have not risked my job or risked my whatever. So, he looked disappointed. Then just before the visit finished, my superior said 5 minutes left.
Yeah.
At that moment, Mandela tried his luck. He asked me again, Mr. Brown, is it possible to ask your superior if you just can see the baby when my wife walk away from the building? Because through that window you can see the doors open outside when he walked away. Then I asked him and he said to me, Brandt, if you can get hold of that baby without Winnie Mandela, no. You can show him the child. Because he knew Mandela already more than 5 years, which he worked on Robben Island.
Mm-hmm.
I was just a new one day.
Yeah.
So he knew, and there was no other warders at that stage. So My answer was no, the window was closed. And when Winnie Mandela has been taken back to the waiting room, other visitors gave her the baby back. And when Mandela stand up this side, he looked at his notes and he said, Mr. Brandt, I forget something. Can you please pass this message to my wife? Tell her she must apply for a visit for Christmas Day. And that time my superior was already, he was in a rush to visit us. He said, what is the delay? Why you don't bring out the prisoner? Explaining what Mandela request. And he said to me, Brandt, call his wife back that he can tell him himself. That time when he get that side, the warders put on the other prisoners, visitors already. Winnie sat with her baby, there's nobody to look after the child. I look at the situation and say, ma'am, can I help the baby? I never touch a black child. She pushed it in my arm, grabbed the handbag, take out some money. At that moment I said, I can't take the money, I just hold it here while you go back in the visiting booth. And she was begging me, which I said, no. When I locked her in the visiting booth, Mandela passed his message from that side. My superior closed the window, switched off the microphones, and then he sent me a passage and came to me. And that moment when he came to me, he took the baby out of my arms.
Mr. Mandela.
He's a child twice and there was tears. When he knocked on the door that side, I can take it quickly back from him, go to the site and apologize a lot and pay for the baby. And that was being kept a secret for many, many years.
And she never knew that he saw.
She never knew it till he was the president of the country. And then on one occasion she heard what he tell the members of parliament that I smuggled the baby film on Robben Island.
Right. I hear news about a question. Thank you for coming in on the questions. The question asked by one of our viewers, how was Mr. Mandela different with his family versus with his fellow ANC followers?
Yeah, was he different?
Yes.
He treated his fellow ANC prisoners inside as his family, because his family was outside. But he would treat them with the same view, even his different political connect with his family, but it was also for him difficult because Winnie Mandela was a lot of times under house arrest.
Yeah.
Then she could have not come even for a year. There was a time when she was sentenced to prison and was sitting in prison for a long while and detained, which he had never seen her.
Yeah.
Then his children could have not also come. But one of his daughters was married to a prince and she get through the government officially permission to see her dad. But then that time they was not allowed to talk anything outside, just a family bond. Because otherwise the prince was also in trouble and not allowed in the country again.
So it all had to be secretly.
Very secretly.
Yeah. And you technically broke quite a few rules whilst working as the guard at Robben Island and later on in Portsmouth prison. Did you ever feel scared? Have there ever been times that you thought that you could be watched or arrested?
You know, I was being watched. I was being followed by security branch, my telephone was been listening devices in. But I always make sure, because I start knowing the guys who work for National Intelligence, I start knowing the guys for security branch. I visit their offices. I made it a point to greet them, and when I see one of the pets, I greet them, introduce myself, to knew these guys, and I knew who was following me. And that year, my brother-in-law worked for the post office. He tell me there's a bug thing on a sleeping device on my telephone line. So I never use my telephone line for without phoning my family. And then I don't talk about my work.
Yeah.
So I was not worried about being catched out. But I was sometimes worried when I collect things at the places, you know, to give it to Mandela. There was, for instance, Mandela's lawyer, Advocate Dalla Omar.
Yeah.
And now I must send a message to Dalla Omar, but it was difficult. Yeah, I can't contact him, can't phone him. His phone is also back. So Kathrada told me, Dalla Omar's wife has a fruit store on Salt River Market. Then me and my wife just stop there, buying vegetables here and buy something there and look in the fruit stores, if we buy fruits there. And then I passed Mrs. Omar's fruit store, gave her a message and just walked on. And know something, buy something from her and just walk on, as if I don't know her. And that's all. Then she will make sure the message gets to Dalla, and that was her husband, Dalla Omar.
Yeah.
The message goes through and then things will happen for the old man.
Quite a challenge.
There was a few times. Then it was later when Mandela's studies was very difficult to get the study material in.
Yeah.
Then there was a lady, Khadija Valley. She worked for Imosa Associates, also a law firm which associated with political prisoners. And then she had a number. When I phoned from my office in Portsmouth prison, I phoned a number. I asked for Khadija Valley, of Mrs. Valley. I would not ask. I said, Mrs. Valley, I'm looking for X so and so that is for studies for prisoner. And what just if you can arrange it, and I will have the funding ready, how much it costs. She will give me immediately a price. And then the next moment, they said they delivered it at Portsmouth Gates. Some supplier delivered the books there for me. They're nicely wrapped up in maybe UNISA stamp or some stamp is on it. I collected, go through it, and give it to Mandela to make it easier for his studies.
Yeah. And that wasn't dangerous? That
I keep my blind. If I said why from the teacher, I said that is the information which I get to order study material.
Yeah.
I don't know how she registered. I think they registered some business school or something. And even as a lawyer from a business school registered, I could have found the institution.
Yeah.
And I just speak to Mrs. Verdi there in Clark and I get my documentation.
And how you said in the earlier meetings that we had that Mandela was not a friend per se, but more like a teacher to you.
Mandela was a father figure for a lot of young boarders.
Yeah.
He always motivated, tell them to study, let them believe that study is the future of our country. Mm-hmm. And through studies, he will also become creative and become an officer. And then through that, he believed he will deal with him better.
Yeah.
He said, if a person educated person understand things better in life. And that was his belief. How long are you the educated person, better they understand them, assist them, help them.
Yeah.
And that was his way of helping people.
He was also quite institutional of creating the Robben Island University, isn't it?
That was his idea. You know, in criminal prisoners fall in love with each other. They sodomize each other and they do all these funny things and they do gangsterism and they murders and all these things occur through this and drug trafficking and things. But Mandela knew that type of things in criminal prisons. So he tried to change the minds of the people. Hardship during the day, the prison authorities oppress on them. In the evenings they must sit with their books and educate themselves. And if believe through education, people will become better and they will understand better. And through education, you don't think about low-class, wrong things doing in prison like criminals think. Criminals have boring, they don't study, they do nothing. They're sitting there and they look how they can irritate each other. But he believe through studies, you can help each other.
Yeah.
And that has really worked.
Yeah.
So he changed the Robben Island to university.
Was he a natural leader in Robben Island?
I would believe he was a natural leader.
He
was not a person who takes decisions on his own. He was not a person really... Yes, when there's something wrong in the section, he just take initiative and do it on behalf of everybody. He will consult with Walter Sisulu. Walter Sisulu was like his mentor.
Right.
And he will always believe in Walter Sisulu. Like he teased me, a lot of times he teased Walter. And he said, Mr. Brandt, you know, and he was working there in a small garden. He said, you know, Mr. Brandt, you see that old man? If it was not for him, I should have never been in that prison. I said, why? He said he was the one who introduced my first wife, then he's the one who bring me to the cities, he was the one who introduced me to the ANC, and how do I do life sentence with him? You know, they always made that type of jokes inside,
yeah.
And he was always teasing Walter about that,
yeah.
But not seriously.
And Walter Sisulu and Nelson Mandela formed the first black law firm in South Africa?
No, I think Walter Sisulu and Oliver Tambo,
they did.
First black law firm, Oliver Tambo. Not Sisulu.
Okay.
Sisulu was the one who ran away and bring Mandela from the rural areas to the city.
Right.
He helped him to get a job in the mines.
Yeah.
And let him help to educate himself. And then he formed what, and then Sisulu introduced him to the ANC. And from the ANC they met Oliver Tambo and they formed a law firm.
That's
to help the poor people and struggle people and defend him in court cases. One of the first black firms in South Africa.
Yeah. Interesting. There's still a chance for our viewers to send in questions. Type it in through the Facebook system and it will be passed on to me on my cell phone. That's why I look at my cell phone from time to time. Coming back to the warm feeling that Mr. Mandela gave you, that continued after he left prison.
Mandela was like a father to me, assist me, help me, everything, but he was a humble, down-to-earth person. The same Mandela exists when he became the president. He acknowledged me, still the humbleness, still the same person, never changed. Things didn't go up to his head and he didn't recognize people. He recognized me as his warder and welcomed me always to his office. always let me feel I'm the most important person in his life, which is here today. And even when he retired, he was still kept an humble person. And there was occasions where I visited him when he was really old, he was not flexible enough, when he sit with his legs up, when he wanted to stand up to greet me, I said, no, but he must sit, relax, relax, don't stand up. He still wanted to stand up to greet me.
Yeah.
Then I tried to calm him down, sit, relax, and sit. You know, and he wanted to show his respect.
Yeah, always a gentleman.
Always a gentleman.
Yeah. And you were also quite close to his family.
Yes, I was close. There was arguments between me and his wife on many occasions where I must chase her away from prison and everything.
Yeah.
But we understand each other later very much. And Winnie Mandela, on one of the book launches, she said what a wonderful person I was, all the years assisted with the visits, and she had never had problems with me, and how I was helpful. Even small incidents happened.
Yeah.
We were human beings, and she treated me with high respect, and she wrote a very nice passage for me in my book, which she signed for me.
Yeah, yeah. Fantastic. Yeah. What was it like staying on Robben Island for these long periods at a time?
Yes. The island to stay in Robben Island, you know, there was a small uprising in South Africa. We are on standby.
Yeah.
We're patrolling day and night around Robben Island, patrolling for any attack to the island, of any escape from the island, of anything going wrong, go wrong, which I believe would not happen, yeah. But we was put on standby. Sometimes I'm there for 3 months before I can get weekend off.
Really?
The island become like a prison for me.
Yeah.
We lock the prisons at night. After that, I go to the single quarters. We was a small group, run around the island, 11 and a half kilometers, take a shower, go and have our dinner. From dinner, we go to the bar, play maybe a little pool of darts, drink a beer or two, and then go to bed.
Yeah.
But sometimes we play some sports. I was also playing some sports on the island,
yeah.
Athletics, and then we're looking for any deal which happened, because sometimes there's some fun runs in Cape Town. To get off the island, the Robben Island one, the prison wardens to assist the end also built up the image of Robben Island.
Yeah.
I always enroll me to fun runs to get that side, and even I run. Then
yeah.
There were some times when it's quiet and they want to arrange, there was maybe that this was wrestling very popular in South Africa. Then they said only the guys who buy tickets for wrestling. The ticket was quite expensive for me that time. My salary was not even 100 rand a month, but I bought a ticket. Now we can go legally over. When I get that side, I'm standing there looking for the people in queue who want to buy a ticket. I sell my ticket immediately, take my money back, and then I go and visit my girlfriend. Then I already speak to the skippers. They said, no, they will leave 2 o'clock tonight. Resting come out by 11-ish. Then the people all want to move into the city, have a few drinks and enjoy themselves. 2 o'clock the boat will leave the waterfront. Then I make sure I'm already half past one in the waterfront.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah. That was your way of dealing
getting to that side.
With the long state. Everybody always talks about how mentally strong Mr. Mandela was, also during his stay on the island and later on in Bosmore and Victor Verster. How come? What made him so strong? Why was he never broken, as you said? That
you know, Mandela was a person who think of discipline. He was a very disciplined person.
Mm-hmm.
And what made him strong? He always believed, and even his comrades around him start thinking things are running wrong, or things is not going to work. He let them believe that the world, they will be free one day. Even if not free, they died in prison, their spirit will be free. But, with the same breath, when youngsters came into prison, like in 76 was uprising, that people only came in 1978 to Robben Island.
Yeah.
Then they get the message, the fires, and they still continue outside. The organizations are still alive. They're still fighting the oppression of the government of the time. That gives him more strength. And he always built on his strength and said, comrades, the flames never go down. And when somebody's been released from prison, he keeps that the struggle must still continue to the outside. People mustn't relax and forget about it and accept what the government is doing. He's still keeping people motivated to carry on with the struggle. And he believed the longer he sit in prison, the more oppression from the outside will come onto South Africa and sanctions will be on South Africa. It forced the government to change something. And there was prisoners on Robben Island who took two double life sentences in over 100 years. Which said, why must I study?
Yeah.
He said, comrades, you must prepare you for freedom. Even if you died in prison, you can see the certificates will be sent to your family. They can look at the certificates and say, our beloved father, brother was on Robben Island. He was fighting for freedom. He was preparing him for the freedom to be leading our country. But he died in prison. And that's a symbol. He didn't sit in prison and just do nothing.
Yeah.
He was to obtain his degrees and obtain his qualifications and could have led the people of the country.
Yeah. Yeah. So that he still believed in a good result.
That's correct.
Yeah. And what about the other prisoners? Like Katrada or...
You know, on Robben Island, there was also, I will tell you about the most arrogant prisoner on Robben Island. His name is Atimba Yatoiwa Yatoiwa, my best friend.
Yeah. From Namibia.
From Namibia.
Yeah.
He was our only prisoner. Don't want a letter from outside. When a letter came, he said he don't want it, take it away. He don't even want to look at it. He never sent a letter out. When a visitor applied for visits, people can come to the waterfront. He said, send them back, I don't want to see them. That happened one day, his mother came. Mm-hmm. She was 90 years old. The old lady was blind. People bleated to the waterfront, and then the official said, put her on a boat. We will guide her from this side to the visiting location. We put her in the visiting location, and then Adima Yotoyeva said, no, you don't want to see his mother. Even she's blind, he don't want to see her. Send her back. He refused. Then the head of the prison think, no, we must fight this old man. We must get him back on some way. Let us do something. This lady is blind. Bring her to the prison. Bring her to the head of the office. Make her sit behind the door. I go to Yotoyeva that day, and I said, Yotoyeva, the head of the prison not accept your conditions and said, you don't want to see your mother. He said, you must come and tell him himself. He said, sir, you can take me, and I take him to the office, the major's office. Major Harding was there, and we come in, he said, run closer to her. He said, Yatoiwa, why you don't want to see your mother? When you want to see, I'm a Namibian. I'm illegally kept in this country, and I don't want nothing from your government. His mother started talking from behind the door. And then he was trapped inside the office, and he sees his mother there. He just take her hands, sit on his knees, and she was have tears in his eyes that moment, and he started talking to her. And then the major said, leave him, let him carry on with his visit. That's the only visit I knew in the history of the Robben Island, which was not recorded for National Intelligence Security Grounds.
Yeah.
We never recorded the visit. Yeah. But I was part of that visit. This old man's nickname was called Hardegat. And I'm in Afrikaans.
Yeah, yeah.
I never knew this old man could have speak Afrikaans. He respect me very well. Some guard, he not even greet, he's just stubborn, do nothing. And when I was in Namibia,
yeah,
I visited him.
Yeah.
And I was invited to his 90th birthday where I met the president of Ghana, Angola and all these people. And then he said, I must tell them how his behavior was in prison. I said, no, your behavior was Hardegat. And I explained to him, and he was laughing, feel very proud when I tell him that. Because he hardly even greeted me. He was respecting me. And every time he came to Cape Town, he called me. He's in Cape Town. Even last year, December, he was in Cape Town. And he and his wife take me with his daughters out for dinner. And I spent the evening with him.
Fantastic.
And he has passed us in that unit. And I would love to be at his funeral at that stage, but I was not in a country when I get the message.
Yeah,
it was not possible for me to be there.
Yeah.
But I'm still in touch with his wife.
Yeah.
She said, I mustn't forget about him. When I came to Namibia, please phone. We must go out for evening, must stop.
I told you you should go to Namibia. Sure.
Yes, I will. I will try to go next year.
You have written a lot of your memories down in a book that is called Vriendschap in Gevangenschap. It's your memories of you as a prison warden of Mr. Mandela. Can you tell us a little bit about the book, on how it came about?
This book, I didn't want to do a book. That was after my sons died.
Yeah.
In a car accident, Mandela contacted me, and then after that he said to me, Mr. Brandt, there was a gentleman who wrote a book, Goodbye Bafana, and I knew him very well, he was my friend.
Yeah.
We worked together. And he said to me, you must write a book, because I'm very upset about this man, James Craig, who wrote all this untrue nonsense and lies. And he steals some of my documentation to put in his book, after he told me he don't have it. And then after that he distanced him from James Craig.
Yeah.
You don't want to see the guy, you don't want to hear from him, you don't want to see the message from him, you don't want nothing.
Fair enough.
Then he started praising and write a book. And then for 6 years, every time when we meet, he asked me when he remembers, he said, Mr. Brandt, how far are you with the book? I said, I'm busy now with the first scripts and I do research for my diaries and do this. And I kept him on the line. Till he got really fed up with me. And he called a lady in Barbara Jones and he gave her instructions from the Mandela Foundation. 6 months, I must sign a contract. She must keep me to contract, otherwise I will pay. And I signed a contract, which was forced to me, that she must help me with the book. So she will help me with the book.
And you have to help her.
I give her all my diaries.
Yeah.
I give her instructions. She do some interviews with me. She take my feelings out of me, different stages on the island and things with Mandela and any other prisoners gone through.
Yeah.
But Mandela insists the book must be about us. Then the book comes out too long and it must make the book smaller to fit in the contract words.
Yeah.
And then Mandela was very happy about the first three chapters when he read it.
Yeah.
Was very proud about the book. And he even promised me he will want to be at my book launch, my first book launch. It could have not happened. He gets sick, he ends up in hospital. Mm-hmm. After that he passed, and then my book was launched in the UK. Then Zindi Mandela picked up and she said to Mr. Brandt, "You can't run away from me. My last promise to Daddy was, he said if he can't be at your book launch, I must represent him." Then I said to her, "Ma'am, I'm very happy you're here. I never talk to a crowd of people. I'm very shy. I can't really talk so nice English. Now I'm so happy you can talk on behalf for me and on your father." So I feel very blessed that evening my book was well received.
Yeah, fantastic. For all of the people that have been viewing us, we will have a copy that we will make a draw. And one of you will be the happy owner of a signed copy of this book if you leave a message on Facebook. Somebody told me to tell you. A last question. What is your best memory of Mr. Mandela?
My best memory of Mandela was the humbleness. The person who wants to help others around him. He wants to see the light on everybody and the respect he has towards people. And how he treated children. How humble he was for children. How he recognized children.
Yeah.
And he believed that children is our future of our country. He always believed that. And then, and the last thing I can say, he was also the person worried about person's health. He wanted people to be healthy and help each other. And he said also on one occasion to me, he said, "Mr. Brandt, the higher we can educate yourself, the more you can lift others up to educate themselves."
Yeah.
And you don't have to be rich. You can be rich in mind to help others and give it away. Money is not something you can use after your death. Rather use it now to help others which struggle and which is poor, to make everybody have a nice sunshine over all of us.
Yeah.
And that was my memory I've got of him. You must help others around you. I respect people.
A special man.
Special man.
And he made you a special man as well. Thank you very much for being with us.
Thank you.
Thanks so much, Christopher.
Pleasure.